I know everybody's favorite topic. Can you guess it? Really? Okay. I thought it was pretty clear what we were talking about, but okay. I'll try to make the scripture reading more clear next time. How many of y'all know what this is? A barometer. What, so what is this? What am I going to use this to read? Come on, some of them. Electricity. So it makes electricity.
No.
Now what's this do? What's this do? It just tells me, right, how much electricity is there. It doesn't make electricity. What's this? I love this one. It's my favorite. Because it involves eating and it involves meat. Okay. How many of y'all know what this one is? Yeah. You shove this into meat and it tells you if you're going to die by eating it. Pretty sure that's how it works, actually. Right? We all love this one. And then, of course, it's that time of year again. So we have these beautiful little clickers. What's this guy? Thermometer, thermostat, thermostan, I don't know, it has 1500 inch. None of those things create anything. None of them. I don't walk up to a piece of meat and shove this in there and it gets warm. All I do is I stick this in a piece of meat and it says, you know, it's 140 degrees, that's, I'm going to die still. Okay, it's 160 degrees. If it's beef, lamb, or veal, I can eat it. It's 160. If it's chicken, I shouldn't die. But it doesn't create anything. And what we're talking about today in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 is a barometer. A barometer is just a measure, a meter, a measuring stick, a thermostat, a voltmeter. All these things are just measurements. And Paul presents something, and I want you to realize that from the very start, he's going to say, this is not a command. So if you try to make any of this a command, it will not fit the scripture any longer. He actually says, this is not a command. Yeah. I don't know how much clearer you can get. But we are in 2 Corinthians chapter 8. We'll be starting in verse 1. Now, brethren, we wish to make known to you the grace of God, which has been given in the churches of Macedonia, that in the great ordeal of affliction, their abundance of joy and their deep poverty overflowed in the wealth of their liberality. For I testify that according to their ability and beyond their ability, they gave their own accord, begging us with much urging for the favor of participation in the support of the saints. And this, not as we had expected, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and to us by the will of God. So we urge Titus that he had previously made a beginning, so he'd also complete in you this gracious work as well. Did you see it? It's this idea of being surprised. It wasn't a matter of he commanded them to give this certain way. That's the Old Testament. And it is. And I give a lot like the Old Testament. I do. There's a certain chunk that I start with that goes straight to God off the top. And then there's, I actually get to give to God, and that can't be off the top. That's a very Jewish mindset. And the problem with that is, there are commands in the New Testament that do not work with the Old Testament. There's one that we have disputed, and the Church of Christ has been pretty true on this. Tithing does not fit the New Testament. Because a tithe is a command. And I want you to hear his words. His words are this. Begging us with much urging for the favor of participation in the support of the saints. And this not as we had expected. The favor of participation. And it's this idea that instead of saying, you need to do this, there's a hard, fast rule for you. What it is this. We go back to God and we say in the New Testament, we have these new commands that are not new at all. Love God. And the only way to give to God and love Him would not work if we started with a command. Because if you have to do something, what love is there? What love is there in saying, you have to do this? No, that's authority. God has that too. But when he says to give, he says give with a cheerful heart. Give laughing. Could you imagine that if we had communion passed every Sunday morning, and then we come to it, and we separately, we say, we're going to pass this tray, and everybody started laughing. The tray's coming. I'm going to go. It's fine. I mean, it would be a weird church. I mean, people would show up and be scared, but the idea behind it is just that. It's you give, and you're just, we get to participate in that. And it's no longer this command of, you know, the first fruits, and then you've got to bring that. And then after the first fruit have come, you then can give your 10%. And then on top of that, there are certain sacrifices you need to give for, and certain holidays you've got to provide for. And there's this huge sum, and it's all set out. Because there's this one little command in Leviticus. And it's so weird because it's not a real command. It's called the free will offering. And the idea behind the free will offering is this. It cannot be commanded. God says, this is how you can do it. But I really can't tell you how much to do. I can't tell you when to do it. Because it stops being a free will offering. And it stops being this overwhelming pleasure, this joy that we should get in saying, God, I love you. And when we talk about barometers, I want you to think about that with money. If the Beatles came to town, I know some of them are dead, so this makes it really hard for me, but they're my favorite band, so chill. So they come to town, and they're alive somehow, and they're playing at a concert, and they say it's a $200 person ticket. I'm going to say awesome, okay? Who cares? It's the Beatles. Now, of course, you know, so you get some other band come to town. You know, the Monkees, they're my second favorite. And they're like, 200, and I'm like, no, 150. They're not the Beatles by far. Then you get somebody that I hate, Elvis, sorry, what's happening? And I'm like, okay, I might give $20 for a ticket just because, you know, everybody talks about the dude. But money becomes that barometer. I'm saying the Beatles are easily worth $200. The Monkees are worth $150. Elvis, you know, worth $20. Enjoy the little blue suede shoes and dancing in church or something. But in life, we do the same thing. If I say I'm hungry and I really like a pizza, I'm not going to go spend $13 on a pizza because I'm stingy. But if my son comes to me with those puppy dog eyes and says, Daddy, I want a pizza. I'm just like, what kind of pizza are we having tonight? That $13 becomes a whole lot less when I'm talking about my son. Okay, he wants a pizza. I mean, it's not terrible. And when we work with God, it's a lot the same. Money is not anything, does not create anything. It's only a standard of what something's worth. And what he's talking about here is that standard where they gave beyond themselves. Not because somebody said, Paul didn't come down and say, you need to give! Do it! Instead, he said, they begged us. You didn't have people preaching on giving. You had people saying, hey, can we give? Will you let us give? And him being overwhelmed by that, and that it was more than they had expected. But he continues with this barometer in verse 7. But just as you abound in everything, in faith and utterance and knowledge and in all earnestness and in the love we inspire in you, see that you abound in this gracious work also. I'm not speaking this as a command. There it is. I'm not speaking this as a command. But as proving through the earnestness of others the sincerity of your love. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sake he became poor, so that you might become rich. I give my opinion in this matter, for this is to your advantage. We were the first to begin a year ago not only to do this, but also to desire to do it. But now, finish doing it also, so that just as there was the readiness to desire it, so there may also be the completion of it by your ability. For if the readiness is present, it is acceptable according to what a person has, not according to what he does not have. For this is not for the ease of others and for your affliction, but by way of equality. At this present time, your abundance being a supply for their need, so that their abundance also may become a supply for your need, that there may be equality. As it is written, he who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little had no lack. The last phrase in there is a reference to manna. It's a reference to them going out on Friday and gathering enough to cover for Saturday. And it says that those who gathered an overabundance didn't have too much. And those who trusted God and just gathered a basic amount didn't have too little. But he says that it is a standard of love. And too often, we love standards. We love meters. We do. We create meters just to create meters. We do. And meters, I mean like a yardstick. We want to say, well, you know, this is what a Christian does. This is how I show I'm a Christian. And we've created lists of things. We've created lists, and some of them are very godly, and some of them are just tradition. But we want lists because we need them. I don't know if I'm contagious unless I have this little guy right here. Right? Unless I shove this thing in my ear, that's weird enough for me, and then click the little button and wait for it to beep at me, and then make sure to do it two or three times so it actually works. Unless I see this, I don't know if I'm contagious. I don't know if I have a fever or if I just have a tummy ache. And so I use this, and this meter helps me. And money is the same thing. Money helps me. Money shows me what is really important in my life. Because if I look through my finances and I see, you know, how much I'm putting towards God, and I see how much I'm putting towards entertainment, ugh, right? That's a pretty good balance. It's a pretty good meter for me. Chapman wrote this book. It was called The Five Love Languages. It's all about how to be more loving. I like the idea of the book. But his idea was that there are five different ways that we deal with love. And there are five different ways that you experience love. And there are certain things you like better. Some of y'all like to be told how awesome you are. Words of affirmation. Some of you, on the other hand, want affection. Some of you are like, if I get a hug, I'm having a good day. Don't blame me. Some of us, on the other hand, get down to this category that I don't understand. But it's a real category, and we know people like it, and it's this idea of gifts. Gifts. One of the love languages is gift giving. And it's so foreign to me because mine's all affection and like nothing else. But there are those who really experience a lot by receiving a gift. And they're the kind of people who will tell you about a gift they got 3 years ago, and they're like, this made my day, and they'll keep it. And you know, they'll put it in a special place in their house, and they'll go, I remember when such and such gave me this. And though that's not me, and it may not be you, we have to understand that that is valuable. That is a barometer of love. Because there are some of us who honestly, if we take the time, and you know, we spend, you know, don't go to the dollar store, that's what I'm trying to say. You know, we don't give them fly swatter because it was on sale for 50 cents. You know, when we go out and we buy a gift that really means something to them, they're going to treasure it, prize it, keep it. And that's okay. It's not unbiblical. It's not anything we should throw out. It's something that Paul is talking about here. Is that when we look at how we spend money, we can look back on it and we can say, where is my love? You know, what do I love the most? And there's very good things to spend money on. And one of those things is the joy of participating in what God wants to do. Not a command, as he says, just my opinion. Verse 16, he finishes with this. Because we always got to put it back to God. Verse 16, but thanks be to God, who puts the same earnest on your behalf in the heart of Titus. For he not only accepted your appeal, but being himself very earnest, he has gone to you of his own accord. We have sent along with him the brother whose fame in the things of the gospel has spread through all the churches. And not only this, but he has also been appointed by the churches to travel with us in this gracious work, which is being administered by us for the glory of the Lord himself, and to show our readiness. Take precaution so that no one will discredit us in our administration of this generous gift, for we have regard for what is honorable, not only in the sight of the Lord, but also in the sight of men. We have sent with them our brother, whom we have often tested, but now even more diligently, because of his great confidence in you. As for Titus, he is my partner and fellow worker among you. As for our brethren, they are messengers of the churches, a glory to Christ. Therefore, openly before the churches, show them the proof of your love and of our reason for boasting about you. This lesson is not one of command, and I don't want you to get command. I've tried to drill in your head. This is not a command. Thank you. Because too many times in church, you will hear just that. The question is, do you view money correctly? Money is not anything, and it actually has no value if you've never noticed. It's a piece of paper. I'll give you one that's white. I mean, if you'll trade me. I'll even write numbers on it. I don't even care. Here's five. Okay. Here's six. It's a number, right? But if we view money and we take it back and we say, I love God, let's start there, let's finish there, God be glorified. And our money becomes something, and we say, this is the barometer in my life, and I'm looking at it and I'm saying, God, I love you. Is that reflected in the things that I do for you? Is that reflected in the way that I give to you? Is that reflected in the way that I care for my family? Is that reflected in those things that you consider worthy? And we look at money and we say, God, let me use money instead of money using me. Because God has left us that there are all kinds of evils that come from money. He says that money is the roots of all kinds of evils. And it can be. And money can take on a godlike state in which money competes with God, and we got to decide who we're going to serve. But better than that, we can take money as only a barometer and say, God, I love you. Let me use money to see how much I love you. Because that's how Paul's treating here. He's saying, show that proof of your love. Show that generosity that comes from not saying you need to give, but comes from that the favor of participating in the gospel. The favor of helping the Lord achieve something greater than anything we can do. And this week, to really consider how we use money. And not view it as too rich, too poor, but looking at that lady and saying she gave 2 pence, but that's what she had. That's a lot of love. And not judging one another based on any standard, because there is no command. The only standard is this. You need to look at where your heart is. And that is more important than the money itself. The money is just a meter of it. The reality is, do you really love God, or is it words in the air that don't get put down, that don't get shown? But today we end with an invitation. And we're still focusing on those four words. And I want you to read this. I do. I don't want you to just read "there appears to the heart." I want you to read that they heard a message from Peter, and then Peter doesn't do anything. He preaches to them. And then he doesn't say, okay, now come forward. Look what he does. Well, nothing. They said to Peter, because it was in their heart. And everything needs to be taken back to that. Does it start with love? Does it start with you choosing? And in this invitation, you have this. this invitation to believe that Jesus is Lord, to repent of your sins, confess Jesus as Lord, be buried with him in baptism so that you're raised brand new, so that you can live for him at that point. If anybody has not experienced that, or if there's anybody who needs prayers or wishes to submit to the eldership here, we ask that you come now as we stand and as we sing.